think it's too late. I'm just
kidding. All right, we've got sound.
Allison the psychologist.
All right.
Always trying to figure it out. So.
All right. We entitled this one here, Entering the Kingdom of Man, which sounds kind of convoluted. After all, aren't we man? But what we are is a potential fetus developing to give birth into the kingdom of man, as we did yesterday. We call this the gift, and I may create a web page and I may call the whole thing the gift. When Jesus and his disciples walked among men, their presence and teachings were a gift from God to the lost prodigal sons and daughters. There are many statements in the gospel that confirm, for many are called but few chosen. That doesn't mean you say your Jesus prayer and you're all set and everything else. It says, for many are called but few are chosen. So what's the requirements to being chosen, or what's the to enter the kingdom of man? Over the first 3 centuries, there were few who embraced the gift and put it to good use in the escape from the outer darkness of this, the far country. In the manner of the Jews, Christians, and Muslims today, the vast majority of believers threw the gift away, meaning the original gospel teachings. As explained by Paul, because the majority of people were of an animal soul level of consciousness, they were incapable of comprehending the true spiritual meaning of the gospel. So before you go and blame them and everything else, like a lot of people do, including myself, they were incapable of comprehending these teachings, or the essence, spiritual essence of these teachings. But if you try to tell them that they're incapable of comprehending because they're of a fetus or animal soul level of consciousness, of course they get very nasty to you in return. And then when you try to tell someone like the Emperor Constantine that he doesn't understand anything, you would end up being severely dealt with. Why were they incapable of comprehending? Because they failed to live in accord with the teachings of the gospel and the law of God. Now, when you mention the law of God to most Christians, it's a dirty word. What did Martin Luther call the Epistle of James, or the Epistle of Straw? Because he was far too much with the law, you know, they're exempt from the law. Jesus died for their sins. When you consider that James or Jacob was the brother and the mover and shaker, and actually the disciples, the historians will tell you that the disciples were more him than the historical man Jesus, which is a big question mark. To call that the Epistle of Straw is really insanity, spiritual insanity. In the words of the gospel, and this is very important, this is uniform across the whole gospel message, it states, anyone who chooses to do the will of God will find out whether my teachings come from God or whether I speak of my own. That means that if you live by the word of God, you will be taught and evolve, and all these, the knowledge will come to you. You don't need to be taught. But in order to accomplish this, you have to choose to live the law of God, not just give it some rhetoric or appeasement with your lips. Because the vast majority of Christians continue to live in accord with the culture, mindset, and lifestyle of this world, they could not use the scriptures as the key of knowledge and gain entrance into the inner kingdom. There was, from their perspective, this was Gnostic nonsense, that there was an inner kingdom. The key of knowledge, the fact that I was able to get the key of knowledge domain that nobody had ever gotten, shows you that the church has totally ignored that teaching in the Gospels. It's something that you wouldn't be able to get today.
I would think the Jews would have that.
No, they used the key of House of David. So they didn't use the key of knowledge. Like they use the house, they associate the key with the house of David, the key to the house of David. This slide is entitled The Loss of the Gift. The carnal Christians, who are of an animal soul level of consciousness, rejected the whole purpose of the gospel which was to enable the lost prodigal sons to escape the profound ignorance of the far country by entering into the inner kingdom and consciously returning and restoring the kingdom of God within them. This to them was Gnostic nonsense, and all the original gospel sightings that portrayed this ability, they removed or corrupted. You'll find them in the Gospel of Thomas, you'll find them in other of the early Christians writing in the Dogmatic, but not in, so much in our Gospels. Even though Luke 17:20-21 says the kingdom will never come upon the earth because it's within you, they don't believe that.
Or they add to it and say, well, it's also with
that. The Jehovah's Witnesses who use the Westcott and Hort Greek text refutes Westcott and Hort on that, where it says, actually the Greek says, the kingdom of God inside of you is the exact translation of the Greek. They say they could never mean, Jesus could never be saying that to the Pharisees, that they can enter the kingdom. He didn't mean it, so they changed. Well, so they, in their exact Bible translation, the New World Translation is translated in your midst, meaning Jesus was in the midst, but that's not what it says. And if you will go back into the, when you are able to restore the kingdom within you, that's the portrayal of being in the world and not of it. Your body, you're still here functioning, but part of you is connected within yourself, which is, should be the objective of everybody here. Under the control by the citizen of the far country and failing to live in strict accord with the gospel teachings, the prodigal sons became even more lost and spiritually disenfranchised. As stated by John Wesley with respect to the prediction of Paul that the Christians would worship the Antichrist, Wesley stated, that fatal period when the Emperor Constantine called himself a Christian, from this time forward the Christians had no more of the spirit of Christ than the heathens. Very true statement. Once Constantine and a series of emperors took over the acceptable doctrines of the church, we all saw where Theodora deleted the past lives of everybody, same as she deletes emails today, and corrupted the scriptures, hunted down and murdered the genuine spiritual Christians as heretics for not embracing the religion of the emperor. The gift was thrown away and lost, and the church worshiped the Antichrist as continues today, as Paul predicted. Those are Paul's words I'm drawing upon. The knowledge of the soul and the soul's relationship to the Logos was thrown away and lost, immersing the church in a state of profound spiritual ignorance and suffering of the Dark Ages. And believe me, there was suffering in the Dark Ages. Catholic and Protestant alike burnt people at the stake regularly. There was one town, I think in Germany, that there was no women left in the town because they had burnt them all at the stake as witches. All the women were designated witches, and the example of it all, of course, is Gordania Bruno. And if you look into the writings of what I have on Gordania Bruno, he parallels everything I write, just about. I didn't personally know Gordania Bruno, but Emmanuel did. In fact, Emmanuel attended one of his university lectures back in that time. I think I was gone by that time, and Emmanuel was doing, and we went back into that life and looked at what Gordania Bruno taught directly from when Emmanuel sat. In fact, he even met him. Place is falling apart, huh? Every Sunday, the dogma of the citizen of the far country, the Antichrist, is preached from the pulpits of our Christian churches. What Paul called the milk of the gospel is portrayed as non-essential. In rejecting the core essentials of the gospel as presented in the words, anyone who chooses to do the will of God will find out whether my teachings come from God, whether I speak of my own, Christians consign themselves to a self-imposed diaspora of profound, abject spiritual ignorance. I can give nobody any more. Unless you live these teachings, you can't develop, and you'll never understand, because we're spiritual fetuses, mental fetuses, and the mind has to evolve, and we have to come connect with our inner self to learn. Now, I can't do this. Everybody has to do it within themselves by seeking truth and the kingdom. Jesus proclaims in the Gospel of Thomas, but if you will not know yourselves, you dwell in poverty, and it is you who is that poverty. This is true. No truer words are ever spoken. In throwing away the original teachings on the knowledge of the soul, it became impossible for the body of Christians to even understand the spiritual meaning of the Gospel. That's why they preach the dogma of the Antichrist today from the pulpits. In throwing away the key of knowledge in the manner of the Pharisees, the church created a great war between them and the inner kingdom. My soul entered this world this time to restore the gift to the sincere believers who desire truth over man-made dogma. I cannot do anything more than publish what I know, drawn from both my past lives and from the from contact with my own higher soul self. Others here to varying degrees can do the same. If you are able to do this, then by all means help others to find the truth, because in so doing, greater truth will come to you, especially if you live the truth. Remember, the law is you can never possess any greater truth than you're willing to live and manifest in word, thought, desire, and deed. That's basically, I'm dictating from spirit. Because when I began this journey, I had no idea of all this stuff. But I developed over time. And my wife helped developing me. So. The intricate power of the internet has enabled me to utilize the system of hyperlinks to prevail over the three-dimensional limitations of normal written text. And we were talking about this yesterday. I can write in summary, and I can use hyperlinks to connect to in-depth explanations, explaining great dimensions. I've been wanting to write a book for 40 years, but I just can't imagine being limited to a page without having the hyperlinks to explain everything. The book would have to be so huge, it would be bigger than War and Peace. And my original writing was big, probably about the size of War and Peace, which I made the original websites out of. And then I went from there. That's why the websites are much more basic on Nazarene.org than the other websites, because those were most of those were the original website, original writings that I had. Some of the writings I haven't even moved over to a web page, because I've built upon the same knowledge and extended it. But as I myself developed and learned how to, from what has made these writings unique is the fact that I've been running an open forum. Those who you have been here for a long time know that we get adversaries coming all the time. And every time an adversary came, I just addressed their arguments in a website and then explored it and explained it. If you try to do any, if you try to access any of the authors who write books, you can't. They don't have open websites. And if they have forums, they don't run an open forum. So this is what they say, and they never grow from beyond that. I don't think like normal people. Nothing about me would be a normal type of thinking. But yet, when they came here to do battle with me, they put forth their arguments, and those arguments I addressed, and that's how all those websites came about. But not only could I do that, but the power of the hyperlink, where I could make a statement or a paragraph and then connect to a long explanation, can't be paralleled in writing a book. I just don't know how I could put all this stuff in a book, what's considered inconceivable. I've been considering putting some in, but the whole thing, no way. As I say here, I can do and explain any concept of higher reality with a link that presents multi-dimensional realities in great depth without breaking the train of thought in the original presentation. This would be impossible in a traditional book. I couldn't preach this, I couldn't teach this, I couldn't convey this, because it would be such a monumental task, it would be impossible. And that's what the power of the hyperlinks and the modern internet has done. Personally, I think they invented it for me. Fortunately, so many people are attracted to social media and pornography that the internet has grown so wide that it's readily available to everybody. Without the negative side, the positive never could have been born. There are a great number of sincere Christians who have begun to realize that they have been misled by their leaders. They are not satisfied with the milk, but are moved by an inward desire for the solid food that nourishes the spirit and expands the mind and consciousness of the anointed seeker. They came into this life at this present time because they knew all this information would be available, whether it be biblical criticism, science. I use science all the time. No problem. There's no war of religion and science with me. Theology. All this information exists at their fingertips, including the Nicomati Library. Bless you. So all this is present at the present time at their fingertips, and a lot of souls have entered in at this time in order to take advantage of this, because it's a rare opportunity. If you dared speak the truth in the past, you were murdered by the church or by the government. Try being Christian in China. Try being anything other than what's accepted in Russia. They're not even allowed to build a Christian church in Saudi Arabia. No Christian is allowed to enter Mecca. Not allowed.
That's the
Deutsche. So actually, the United States is leading the charge in this freedom of information. And as much as there's those who are wishing to squash that freedom, it still seems to prevail. No doubt there'll come a time where my websites will not be allowed in the present frame, but I'm looking for a new age to come anyway. We're a more enlightened age, but I don't feel this can come without great turmoil. And in the process of great turmoil, I wouldn't be a bit surprised if the internet gets cut off for a time.
What I'd expect is they start trying to, through commercial ventures, they'll start labeling things as hate mail or hate speech.
Well,
they've
been wanting to give the control of the internet over to the UN. If they do that, it's dead.
Yeah.
Do you know, first off, what it would cost you for a domain? Cost me $20 for a domain name? A year, maybe? Do you know what the UN would do with that? If you help others to find the solid food, you yourself will evolve and you will become held in high esteem, and the laws will focus upon you and guide you in the way. If you just sit back and do nothing, no action, this is where I'm going to make Ra angry again, because I tell him he's got a mission that he doesn't want to do other than talking. What was it? Ra is the reluctant monk. In yesterday's presentation, I presented the seven kingdoms. I explored the segments within the one that make up the one, meaning how the white light of the soul is fractured or defractured into the seven colors of the rainbow when it comes into the earth. The seven spiritual centers that, because of segmentation that takes place in this three-dimensional realm, cannot manifest the white light of the soul. So it divides us. So when the New Age tells you, well, I'm just going to overcome my division. Yes, it's really easy. That sounds like the Jesus prayer. 12 spheres of mind are represented in the Tree of Life. I got told by one New Ager just the other day on Facebook, there's no spheres of mind. Spheres of mind.
Oh, really?
Yes. She said, where have you,
How does she explain it?
She doesn't. It's just hot.
Easier to do.
In the previous two segments of this presentation, I explored time as a dimension of mind, and this is one of the most difficult for man to come to terms with. The one on our form who really seems to have always had an image of that is Gary. And he always had this idea that time was not real, not as man looks upon it. I explored the reality that each soul is a single neuron in the mind of God. I further explained that holographically, each soul generated personality, which is what we are, and all the past lives that the soul has lived, I'm portraying as a soul generated personality for that time frame or that mission that the soul was on. As the younger of the two sons in the parable of the prodigal son returns to their source in what I portray as soul mind matrix. In the parable of the two sons, the soul can be personified as the elder son that remains in the kingdom with the father. We are the ones who enter into this world, and we're the youngest son. The church has absolutely no explanation of who the son was that stayed with the father. Some have tried to say, well, that must be the Jews, but then it also says that they were always obedient to God and never went out of the God's will. So who on earth has ever been that way? They can't say it's Jesus, because that means that the youngest son is his brother. After all, if Jesus is God, that can't be. So they have no explanation to interpret the parable of the prodigal son. And it's probably one of the most important parables there is in the Gospels. Yes. With each soul-generated personality taking their place as a single neuron in the mind of the soul, I believe I go into that, there's no personality that's ever lost. We don't reincarnate. No such thing as reincarnation. If reincarnation means that the same personality re-enters the earth like the Easterns believe, then there's no such thing as reincarnation. There's soul incarnations, a multitude of soul incarnations. That's why Origen and the early church fathers taught the doctrine of the pre-existent soul that incarnates over the course of many lifetimes. That's not the same thing as saying that you reincarnate like the Easterners say, that the same soul image incarnates from life to life, passing through the cloud of forgetfulness, which is what they explain. That's impossible. That people reject it is only using their own rational thought. There's also no such thing as going to hell for eternity and going to glory and all the rest. Anyway, I go into that. Let me read the thing in. Once as high reality, the soul that Paul portrayed as inconceivable to the mind of organic natural man is comprehended. Only then can the life of that person be understood as dendrites, connecting the higher mind with the lower earthly mind. Word dendrites is what I forgot to add to yesterday. It was one of my gunners. And I realized today that I forgot to it. If each soul personality is as a neuron in the mind of God, that neuron is connected down into the body. And it's those connections that act as gateways into the lower mind that makes each soul personality important. Connecting the lower mind with the upper mind. What this means is that across the spectrum of mind, that organic man equates with time, and the life that they lived can be portrayed as dendrites or nerve endings, which connect the higher three kingdoms with the lower three kingdoms within the mind of the soul. Does everybody understand what I just said? Because that's...
Rewind?
Yeah. All right. You want to start this over again?
Yep.
We're going beyond. All right. Well, let's get into it this way, going by what I have here. When you go into the realm of souls, the undeveloped souls appear to be like a light of a distant star, flashing, whatnot, weak little stars. This is the vast majority of the people on the earth. They've never really developed. They've been followers. They're as Ra would say, on automatic, mechanical man. The more the soul begins to evolve, the greater the light. If you was to look at the soul of Obama, Bush, Putin, and all these souls are much more greater light. I don't portray them as spiritually advanced because they're not. They're just advanced, they're leaders, they're movers and shakers. There's no doubt that someone like Obama and Trump and Putin and the rest are movers and shakers. They always come to the top as leaders, from life to life to life, and by doing this, they develop. A spiritually advanced soul would appear as a great, immense light. Most people, if they were drawn up into the realm of souls, and they came into the presence of one of these spiritually advanced souls, they think this is God or Jesus, much more so than they do right now with the near-death experience. Which provokes the ultra-important question, what is the source of the light in the spiritually advanced soul? And that's what that's what your question's focusing on. What is the source of the light? Unless you can answer this question, you dwell in the intellectual and spiritual poverty portrayed in the Gospel of Thomas. So, we're going to take you out of poverty today. We're going to answer the question. Yesterday I explored the reality of the soul as a spiritual embryo, a spark of the divine mind as portrayed in Kabbalah, or what they call Kabbalah today, which is basically Jewish mysticism in the Zohar. Notice I didn't say yeah. Having within itself the seven kingdoms as personified in the seven colors of the rainbow. Each soul personality that soul generates into this world is as a single embryonic neuron in the mind of the soul. Your mind is made up of the multitude of many points of intellect, neurons, that control the rest of your body, interact with the rest of your body. It's not a single neuron that goes from life to life, evolving into a big amoeba, like the Easterners say. It's not a subject, like the Christians say, that goes and glorifies and praises the Jesus God. Each soul personality the soul generates into this world is a single embryonic neuron in the mind of the soul, connecting the lower three kingdoms with the upper three kingdoms, which evolve the white light of the soul. So it's the marriage. Here we use the word marriage because the lower three kingdoms is female, reflective, in relation to the upper three kingdoms, which is active. But in this marriage, they grow the soul. And this is where the great white light comes from. Now, someone like Obama or Trump or Putin or whatnot have never achieved soul birth. And while they may be advanced souls, they've never worked on the spiritual birth. So if we take the next stage of birth as entering the kingdom of man, which is the fourth kingdom, until you attain that kingdom, you can't work on what's above it. Which means you need the marriage of the lower three kingdoms and the upper three kingdoms in the center in order to evolve spiritually. Does that somewhat answer your question?
I think so.
Now you're evolving, what you're doing here is you're working on your lower nature. Remember yesterday we portrayed that you take a piece of the pie of the soul, just like the soul has a slice of the pie of God, and that the lower three kingdoms are this brute consciousness, the lower nature. You're here to evolve that. This is the reflective personality, or the reflective energies of the seven chakras, and you're evolving these lower three kingdoms to make them come together in the center and provide a fit platform. If you can bring those seven spiritual centers together in the center, you will be a being of light walking the earth.
So it's like the white light splitting
through
the prism.
You remove the prism is what you're doing, because the white light of the soul can't come into this world directly unless you make it come into the world by bringing oneness across the spectrum. That's why Jesus, when he healed, If you look in the ancient, more ancient texts, like the King James Version, or probably even the TheWay, which is Catholic, Jesus made them whole. He that is whole needs not a physician. Of course, Christians don't believe that. They don't need the Jesus God, but that's what he said. I don't come to call the righteous, meaning the Essenes, and those like them, Essenic people who were spiritual and lived a spiritual lifestyle. I come to call those who are sinners to wholeness. He that is whole need not a physician. Did I answer your question, Sean?
I think so. I guess the part I was struggling with was the dendrites. And I think what you're saying is it's...
You're creating avenues into the lower nature.
Okay.
Remember, I portray it as you're the breath of the soul. Breath starts at the top, comes down into the lower, and then comes back up. Each time the soul personality is generated, they're connecting a little. That's connecting the bottom and the upper.
Okay.
That's why when they teach you to breathe, you breathe into the solar plexus, then you bring it into the center. Like this, into the center. And that's how you connect the breath. That's what the soul is doing every time it generates a personality into the world. It's connecting the lower three kingdoms with the upper three kingdoms, making them into a marriage, bringing them forth as one. If you look in the Casey readings, you'll see his instructions on breathing. Breathe in to the solar plexus, and then breathe into the center. That's what that's all about. You're being born, being originated as a soul-generated embryonic image into the physical body, which is comprised of the lower three kingdoms. What you do here with those three kingdoms in making it incompatible or an environment for the upper three kingdoms to manifest and then bring that into the center, this is how the soul, light of the soul grows. This is why the version of that saying in the Gospel of the Nazarenes says you enter through the center. The Gospel of Thomas just talks about making the male and the female one the same, the above and the below. But the version of that in the Gospel of the Nazarenes says, you make the below, above as the below, and the male, female, one, the same, and enter through the center. And that's what that's all about. Through the fourth kingdom, by entering the kingdom of man, and becoming man. In fact, I think I have that here. All right, let me go with this and this, whatever. Those prodigal sons who remain status quo with the thinking and lifestyle of this world are only capable of making progress at a snail's pace. The laws, which we talked about, the difference between the deist theology and the theist theology, where the laws are forcing them to slowly evolve. Now, if you're willing to wait eons to evolve, that's up to you.
Eons of suffering
lots of times. This is a good time. Because the source of light, knowledge, and truth is within them, those prodigal sons who live the necessary consecrated life, seeking the inner kingdom, are able to evolve and increase the light of the soul. That's what you're doing. Who was it that was impressed when I portrayed us as the savior of the soul? When we become the son of man, we're the savior of the soul. I used to tell my higher self, I'm just getting you out of all the trouble you got into your past lives. Ask her, she'll tell you. That's how he got, and he used to say bad things back to me, and that's how we gave him the name Smaz, meaning smartass. In fact, this computer right here, the name of it is smartass, meaning for my higher self. This is what the conversation we used to have. I'm here suffering, being your savior. Now this is a totally different mindset than what the church gives, or the yogis give for that matter, or anybody. But this is a Gnostic, a pure spiritual gnosis, which is lacking today. I'm their savior. I had to take on all their suffering, all the nonsense that they did in the past lives, and redo it in order to bring about that stage of birth that most of them failed. Fortunately, a lot of mine were good guys and they succeeded. That's why I'm able to do what I can do today. People here have advanced spiritually. That's why you're here listening to me. The other people think I'm a madman, like in Plato's cave. That's why they don't listen to me.
Those dendrites, is that where, like everybody says, you know, it's like remembering? Is that?
Well, it's a connecting link.
Yes, the connecting to the...
Connecting.
Dendrites, so it's a, oh, that's true, because I can feel it.
Can you feel it?
Yes.
Do you want to get before the camera?
No.
No? Anyway, because the source of light, knowledge, and truth is within them, these prodigal sons who live the necessary consecrated life, seeking the inner kingdom, are able to evolve and increase the light of the soul. Son of Man is a savior, and he's actually the savior of the soul. This is the what is the Son of Man? Isn't he the child of the man? Isn't that what you're trying to become? When they ask the question in the Gospel of Thomas, we as children, can we enter the kingdom? They're the children of the kingdom. When Jesus said, you must receive the kingdom as a child, this is what he was talking about. He's not talking about child baptisms. This is accomplished by becoming a connecting link across the seven kingdoms, merging the lower three kingdoms with the upper three kingdoms within the individual soul. And that's important. What you're doing is you're marrying the lower three kingdoms to the upper three kingdoms in a divine marriage, bringing them into the center where white light can manifest instead of the divided seven. Yes, but you become the environment that the soul can inhabit.
Right.
Jesus became the environment that the Logos, or mind of God, can inhabit.
Or the arms and the legs.
You will do eventually accomplish everything that Jesus did.
Yep.
Which is why the gospel proclaims, anyone who chooses to do the will of God will find out whether my teachings come from God or whether I speak of my own. And that's the only thing you can do. Only by doing the will of God can you be taught by God. And these truths can be revealed. There's no excuses, no dogma which exempt you from fulfilling the gospel. That's all a lot of Roman dogmatic nonsense. I have a picture here, once again, the tree of life over the man with star representing the laws. Of course, the tree of life is the embodiment of the mind, which covers the whole body. The star of David is the laws, the perfection of the laws. This is what Jesus said, you must perfect the law within you. The fulfillment of the law, the tree of life represents the 12 spheres of mind. The star of David represents the fulfillment of the law, evolving the soul to wholeness and completion as Jesus and the Gospels teach. Every soul is destined to bring this condition about within itself. Time is measured in eternity. If you want to take eternity to do this, then you can continue, then your soul can continue to suffer under these consequences of this life. Personally, the only thing I'm afraid of is ignorance. I have a daughter who achieved soul birth in four lives. And she's so ignorant that she invokes fear in me. If this can happen to her, then it could happen to me. The really good thing about her is she loves me. That's Jennifer. Every soul is destined to bring about this condition with himself. Every soul-generated personality is personified in the prodigal son or daughter, is ultra important to the process of soul evolution and the expansion of soul light. Because every one of us builds that pathway between the seven kingdoms. You do not reincarnate in the manner of the teachings of Eastern milk, meaning your personality. You already have your place. In order for you to reincarnate as the Easterners teach, you would have to have a one neuron mind that keeps channeling in and out of the earth. That's not the way it works. They talk about that everything's written in the Akashic records as if there's a big record book that the past is written in. That's a lot of malone. That's all that is Eastern milk. The past is a dimension of mind. It's living. You can move in it. You can even jump time and have personalities in the past come into the present if you depend upon who you are. Neither do you go to glory if you believe in the Jesus God of Constantine, or go to hell for eternity in the manner of the Roman dogma. You're a valuable resource to them because you are, even if you fail, you still bring something to the table in your movement. And either that, you invoke karma and you're going to force a future soul personality to undo all what you did. Each soul personality is representative of an important aspect of the mind of the soul. Because the mind is not a one-cell neuron. That would be an idiot. Same as God, when they portray God as oneness. Oh, we're all just God, and there is nothing else. That's the divine amoeba that the collective consciousness doctrine worships. Each soul is an important aspect of the divine mind of God. In review, the Gospel of the Nazarenes, Jesus states, and this is again a review of yesterday, love you one another and all the creatures of God, yet I say to you, not all men are men who walk in the form of man. Meaning, when you were born into this body, you were born as a fetus when you gave birth on the next level, and you have to achieve the next stage of birth. Just as important is the Essene Gospel of Peace, which states, therefore I teach you only those laws which you can understand. Why can't you understand? Because you're thinking with an animal consciousness. And which you can understand, that you may become men, meaning you may be born into the kingdom of man in this womb of Mother Earth, and follow the seven laws of the Son of Man. Organic man has absolutely no idea that these are as that they are as fish swimming in the sea of laws. You can't tell people about the laws because they just think they're just living their life independent of everything. The best way to portray man as a fish living in a sea, and the laws are as the water. You're swimming in the laws of God, and everything you think, do, and say has an impact upon you. There's simply no means to explain to all organic man the facts of life from the perspective of the laws that control every aspect of the life they're living. I've tried. I can't do it. You can't explain to a Christian. Lawlessness. 2 Corinthians 6:13. Do not be bound together with unbelievers. For what partnership have righteousness and lawlessness? Or what fellowship have light with darkness? Those what Paul is saying have nothing to do with the people of this world and taking on their ways. Be ye therefore separate, it says right after that. Matthew 7:21-23. Not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, will enter the kingdom of heaven, but only he who does the will of my Father in heaven. Many will say to me in that day, Lord, Lord, did we not prophesy in your name, and in your name to drive out demons and perform many miracles, just like they do in the Benny Hinn's of the world and whatnot? Then I will tell them plainly, I never knew you. Depart from me, ye workers of lawlessness. If there is a Satan, that the power of Satan is working through these people to draw in people as followers, because the truth is within. Matthew 5:16-20. In the same way, let your light shine before others, so that they may see your good works and give glory to your Father who is in heaven. Do not think that I have come to abolish the law of the prophets. I have not come to abolish, but to fulfill them. For truly I say to you, until heaven and earth pass away, not an iota or a dot will pass from the law until all is accomplished, all is fulfilled, and you are made whole. So then, whoever breaks one of the least of these commandments and teaches others to do likewise will be called least in the kingdom of heaven. But whoever practices and teaches them will be called great in the kingdom of heaven. For I tell you that unless your righteousness exceeds that of the scribes and Pharisees, you will never enter the kingdom of heaven. True. Ignorance of the law. While Christians proclaim that they are not under the law, they make this proclamation out of their abject ignorance of what the law is. If it is true that the Epistle of James was written by the brother of Jesus, a and he talks about the law and fulfilling the law. Do you think he didn't know what he was talking about? Or that him and Jesus didn't have long conversations about this law? How someone like Martin Luther can call it an epistle of straw because they're not worshiping the Jesus God of Constantine is just beyond, it's inconceivable. When Jews look upon the law as the law of Moses, this too is a proclamation of their own ignorance with respect to the spiritual meaning of the scriptures. Because the law of Moses is the law of karma, the written text. You have to look within the law of Moses, within the allegory of the written word. That's why Paul called it the letter that killeth. True reality of the law that Jesus makes note of is spiritual. It is our friend. Same thing as we are our soul's savior. The law is our friend, our sustainer. It is a spiritual force that carries us into the kingdom. It opens and unlocks the inner narrow gate to the kingdom. It enables us to sit in the presence of the Logos / Son of God, that is the source of all knowledge. There's not much left here, but the laws are a living biofeedback machine. And when we do live that consecrated life, we invoke the good laws that carry us forth. They are the builder of higher evolved consciousness. It is a force that evolves us to a spiritual maturity. If there is massive evil in the world, this evil is fueled by man's ignorance of the law and its very purpose and of higher objective. Ignorance of the law. Christians remain spiritually flatlined because of the ignorance of the law. All poverty and suffering is based upon man's ignorance of the law. The end, unless I have questions. I do have 6 more minutes here.
Alan, you were using a term soul personality. Is that the same as soul image?
Yes.
Okay.
You are a personality. Very different than the past life personalities that you saw.
Right.
You don't want to look at past lives anymore because of what you saw.
Yeah.
But I also have, that word personality messes me up because then I also have false personalities within this personality, right?
That's holographic.
Yeah.
Personality has personalities.
And some of those false personalities I have might be resemble personalities of another soul in it.
Can't be all bad.
Yeah.
You're doing good, right?
Yeah, I think so.
You live separate and apart from the world.
Yeah.
You only go to work because you have to.
Yeah.
So you're succeeding.
Right.
You're seeking truth. Everybody here is in the position to advance spiritually. But you do so by helping others. All the lives that I, as Jacob, I took the mishmash of the Torah and Old Testament and made it usable for the common person in the original gospel, which is not in existence today as far as I know. But Judaism was an ancient mystery religion. Their scriptures were written by the Essenes. Today the Essenes are known as heretic Jews, basically. The Jews don't accept them. They believe in reincarnation, they believe in all this mysticism and everything else. That's not Jews. They didn't follow the little word of the Torah. Well, as Jacob, I eliminated the necessity to go to a teacher and put out in words of man stuff that could be understood. Remember, the law is that if you begin to live the truth, greater truth can be given to you. And that's what the gospel does. That's what the Sermon on the Mount especially does. And helping others and doing this work in every life that I've excelled has been because I excelled helping other people. As Matthew, the 4th century Ebionite, used to travel all around the empire helping the Gentile converts, helping the Gnostic congregations understand. They knew who I was. They were that wise. I was born an elder into the Ebionites. They said, he's coming. And he has a connection to Jesus. These people are too disenfranchised to even understand that. People here are not. people on the forum. I'm constantly getting people become, I'm going to have a multitude of followers on Facebook, and I don't do enough actually on it. I got to get down and get back to work now that I got finished with this. This is how you advance. You advance by living and helping others. Did I answer your question, Sean?
It's in there. I'm about 75-80%.
You have a marriage between you. The marriage of the lower three kingdoms with the upper three kingdoms. What does the Gospel of Thomas say? It says, when you make the above like the below, when you make the above like the below, and the left like the right, and the inner like the outer, and the male and the female one and the same, then you'll enter the kingdom. It's, there's the blueprint for walking in the way. Of course, it's a lot easier said than done.
Yeah. The three lower are animal, mineral, and plant.
Yes.
Right? So what are the three?
Well, that's...
I've never been able to make
I've
that.
Written on it someplace, but it's the...
It's in the 600 series.
It's in the 600 series?
Yes, it posts what they are. It's the elder son... The
prodigal, which is the lower of the will center,
yeah, in that.
And the balance, which is the third eye,
yeah.
Or the.
Well, it ultimately doesn't matter though, as long as you work on the lower. Right?
You work on the lower, it doesn't matter. You just create. You're just ordaining the marriage.
Yeah.
And when we say animal nature or lower animal nature, that's something different in a way than the three lower kingdoms. I mean, there's the animal kingdom, but the...
We're talking about consciousness. Like the dog has a consciousness.
Yeah. The lower of consciousness.
Yes, that basic animal consciousness that makes us jump on people and make war and terrorize and burn or people, cut their heads off and bark at them and do all these things. The appetites that say, me first.
Lusts.
All these things, the lusts. Was it the seven deadly sins? You're a Catholic.
Mm.
These are all part of the lower nature. These are things you have. You don't reject them, you refine them.
You use them, right?
Yes. And they connect. The only reason they're sins is because they're expressed outwardly. When you begin to express them so that they connect with the upper and the lower, they're gifts.
Mm-hmm.
Strengths.
That seems to be getting riled up with this discussion. I think his animal nature's nature. You don't want to get out
there. Well, yeah. Go ahead, sorry.
Go ahead. Express thyself.
Well, I guess one of the things I was thinking before we break or head out or whatever is, you know, where to start, to be honest with you. But I was thinking we're all here, and my own view, this is almost like we're all kind of a puzzle trying to put together somehow. Each of us has strengths and weaknesses and so forth. And, you know, I just... kind of go around the room and I was thinking about, well, this individual's good at that, this one's good at that.
And if you begin to pool your strengths and start building a spiritual community, that's where you'll find your success.
Yeah.
All right.
I had a question about your fear of ignorance. You mentioned to your daughter, Jennifer, I'd seen the post in the library where she worshiped the mall god.
Where what?
She worships the mall god. Is that the one in New York that's always shopping, worships the mall?
Yeah.
She worships
the mall goddess.
So what I took from that post in the library was, after that, it really helped me to not judge other people, because if a daughter of yours could worship the mall god, then but I took from that her soul had chosen that as part of seeking wholeness. But what you said, that you feared ignorance and used her as an example.
You also understand. You also understand that Jennifer is my stepdaughter, right?
No, I didn't understand.
Yes. Yeah. So she loves me more than anybody else.
Yeah. But
ask her. She'll tell you.
Because you're her favorite. She's your favorite daughter.
She pisses off the rest of them.
But there is a reason to be afraid. I mean, she's attained soul worth four times.
Yes.
Won't this just be a...
So that means that in four lifetimes she was able to work on achieving spiritual birth. And that's a whole another track all in itself.
Right. I'm saying
the Buddha achieved entrance into the kingdom of man, achieved soul birth, and he began his journey into spiritual birth. Jesus is portrayed in the Gospel of Matthew as having achieved or perfected three births: physical, the mental, and the spiritual. 14, 14, 14, you know how to read the numbers. And then he was working on the final birth, which is absolute oneness with the Logos and mind of God.
What I'm asking about is, you said you were fearing ignorance. I'm thinking if she's done that in the past, what karma can she incur going to the mall? Why would ignorance...
This is what her soul is experiencing in this life. We don't know how she's going to end up. She may begin to put her energies and her what she is to good use. When I was in my 20s, I was totally ignorant of everything. So she's in her 30s. There's no men in her life who would be compatible with her to even provide a husband that which she could advance. And while she will listen to me, I'm not so sure how much she can act on me, on what I write. I set before you Crystal, she's very good. Reba is developing strengths that she doesn't even know where they come from.
Hey, I was just, you said you feared ignorance. I thought maybe there was...
I look at the average person who knows nothing and is subject to this world, who, and I just can't even... It's hard to even want to live their life of ignorance, abject intellectual poverty. It's like they're acting on the just on their appetites and whatever, and what society says. They know nothing, they can do nothing, and they basically just, what Rob puts forth is mechanical man, robots feeding the moon, as Gurdjieff would say.
I'm sorry, I had to laugh.
Well, is it true?
Yeah, this is funny. Gurdjieff's a funny guy.
Organic man is as a flower. In the same way that the vegetable kingdom exudes oxygen, well, organic man is exuding this bioenergy that feeds the organic life of the universe. Very simple. So he has a purpose. Mm-hmm. When organic man wants to change that and begin to utilize that bioenergy, then he can evolve his consciousness. But until then, he's like standing in line waiting to jump off the diving board. What is he doing? He's standing there. And he's going to stand there until it's his turn, until he gets up to where he can do whatever, or any kind of thing like that. Mm-hmm. So he's being maintained there. And that's what we're doing here. The organic man is maintaining God's schoolhouse. In philosophy, they call it the great unwashed. They follow us.
Well, Robert, like I was telling you the other day, when I get in my funks and I go out in the yard and work, I interact with the dirt, the mineral kingdom. But when I'm working with my plants, they're being nourished by the minerals going up in them. But they require the animal, the bugs, the animal kingdom, to interact with them to survive. They can't make seeds to grow again unless they're interacting with the animal kingdom in some way. Whether that's a bug, whether it's a hummingbird or whatever, or me interacting with them. Otherwise, they're going to die.
And actually, you're interacting through the laws in everything you do. Whether it be with the opposite sex, with the being nourished physically, with all the things you're doing, you're actually interacting with the laws. You just don't know it. You don't understand it. You don't understand what you're seeing. So until you're ready to begin to evolve individually, purposely, then you're just being maintained in God's schoolhouse. You're one of the great unwashed. You're feeding the universe because the universe needs your energy in order to maintain the schoolhouse. Same as a school needs funds that support it, or you're the main fundraiser for this world.
And that's an important role.
Yes, it is.
And we have to have a lot of those, right?
And yes, it takes a multitude of them. It takes different races, the two genders, and everything else.
That's my story. When I'm stuck in my corner up there, after this is all over, that's my story. I fueled it, man.
That's why myself and some of us incarnated in the 1800s to save the red race. Because the Europeans would have totally wiped them out if strong souls hadn't come in and stopped the slaughter. And that's what we did because of the importance of the red race to the equation of what's made this country.
Yeah.
Why the blacks were brought here, the browns were brought here, the yellows were brought here, they're all here. And they're all, their energies are being utilized by, on the continent, to create this higher consciousness. Now I see nothing but higher consciousness. The very fact that I can write what I write and everything else and live as I'm living, that's a lot better than it used to be when they used to hunt me down as a heretic. Mm-hmm. And all that's possible because of what our constitutional fathers did. They got the church out of the government. They outlawed the elitists. A lot of the original movers and shakers in the Constitution times wanted to make King George all over on this continent. That would have brought a European-type government here. That would have been a disaster. They were smart enough not to create a democracy where whatever the absolute will of the people is works, and they created a republic. This is not a democracy, it's a republic. They were smart enough to realize that an overpopulated state like California could sway every election. So they created the Electoral College, which of course a lot of people want to do away with today because they don't understand it. They made sure all these things were put in place so that we could have this, what they call American exceptionalism. Now, this is the environment. This is the environment that I'm using at present to restore those teachings that were thrown away by the church. And it's not that they're unique. Anybody, the soul of the most, Jacob's soul, knows greater truth than all the intellectuals that are presently living in this world. Has access to greater truth than all the libraries known to man. Jacob has Down syndrome. Which means you have the ability to tap into that source of light and truth. All you gotta do is live your life so you can do it. You don't have to listen to me. What did Jesus say? All you gotta do, those who live the world, law of God will prove the truth for themselves. That's a verse you never hear in church.
I don't think I've ever heard that verse.
That's right. I've never heard it out of the lips of a preacher. You don't need me, just live the law of God and you'll know the truth because you'll see that I'm speaking the truth. And that's the only way to confirm that you're living the truth.
That's also, by the way, in Exodus 24-7 where it says everything God says we will do and we will hear.
That's the two ways, isn't it?
We will do.
Isn't that the two ways where Moses tells about the two ways, one of life and one of...
Is it Dadash?
Somewhere, it's close, it's somewhere in that... Discourse, yes.
There are two ways, the way of life, the way of death.
Is it it's Moses or Didache or both?
It's in both.
Okay.
Because it's a universal truth.
In addition to the Gospels, in addition to ancient wisdom, you know, the pagan wisdom that they always tell you about. Oh, and you quote the Plato's cave. Oh, that's paganism.
Yeah, because it happens to come from a Greek. Because God has certain chosen races.
The Jews are used in the Gospels or in the Torah in the same way that a swine and a dog is used. They're just a symbol of what not to be. Though they are one step up from the nations, or totally what not to be. But because they interpret outwardly what must be interpreted within, they remain lost. So it's not the Jewish Old Testament. Actually, it's the Essene Old Testament. And if you want to really make an Essene mad, call him a Jew.
And probably vice versa, right?
That comes firsthand. That comes first. Well, the Jews don't know what the Essenes were. They're clueless.
Still are.
Yes, they are.
Isn't there the Karaites? Don't they know a little more?
Yes, they do. You know why? Back in about the 7th century, they discovered writings that came, that's similar to the parallel to the Dead Sea Scrolls. And that's how they, the Karaites, how do you say it?
Karaites.
I don't know how to pronounce the words, but that's that group back then. They were called the faith-based Jews. And the difference was that they had access to higher writings than the...
Yeah, there's one I read books by, and he publishes Essene stuff in his books. So.
Anything else?
And then it was friends like them.
You are the savior of your soul. You, Sean. You're not a sinner. You're just like a puppy that pees on the floor because he doesn't know any better. We're going through the puppy stage right now with our puppy.
By the way.